Ladies and gentlemen, I am extremely grateful to the organizers of this year's Beijing Forum for inviting me, and I am deeply honored to address this distinguished international audience. This forum has established itself as a world-class venue for high-level constructive intellectual debate on issues of great importance to all people in all countries. I warmly congratulate Peking University and its partners for this achievement and wish this year's forum a resounding success. The theme of this year's forum is highly relevant to some of the key issues of our times and offers an opportunity for much needed reflection and discussion. I am here mainly to listen to you all and learn from you all. And I do beg your indulgence if my modest contribution does not rise to the high standards established in this forum. I will speak about the Arab Spring. And the title I have given my contribution is The Arab Spring, Reality or Mirage. after 5 years after the first spark of what came to be known as the Arab Spring, many people within and outside the Arab world are wondering if there had been a spring at all. And today, even the best informed observers are not sure where the momentous events which are still unfolding will take the region and how they will be impacted by the words and actions of those outside the Arab world and how, in turn, they will affect others in the wider region and farther afield. West Asia and North Africa as a region is central to any discussion of harmony among civilizations. Known as one of the cradles of ancient civilizations, the birthplace of the three major monotheistic religions, and sitting at the crossroad of three continents, its history, both in ancient and modern times, has been bound to external forces and ambitions. It has retained its strategic importance, both in times of war and in times of peace, not least because of the enormous oil and gas reserves that lie beneath its deserts. And of course, in the past few years, the region has been in the limelight as the theater for political turmoil, repression, violence, and destruction, whose impact has been felt well beyond the region's own borders. One cannot fully understand what is ailing the region today without returning to key events of the last century, which show the extent to which foreign intervention has been part of our history. From the Sykes-Picot Agreement and the Balfour Declaration to the Intifadas in Palestine and the two Gulf Wars, key events profoundly affected the course of our history. They are an essential part of our collective memory, and they continue to influence our actions and impact developments in our region. With the end of World War II, it was taken for granted that there would be world peace and a new world order in the Middle East and elsewhere. People were also aware that for humankind to achieve global progress, it had not only to overcome the East-West ideological divide, but to fight colonialism, alleviate poverty, achieve equality between nations and individuals, and establish better governance. In the years that followed, the risks of a new world war were slowly diminished, if not entirely eliminated. Colonialism was defeated almost everywhere, but the world was still divided, with the Middle East caught in the geopolitical ambitions of rival powers. And while the United Nations deserved credit for addressing many crises, it had failed to live up to its promise in the Arab region, where the Palestinian tragedy, in particular, is more intractable than ever and continues to impose untold suffering on millions of innocent men, women, and children. At the end of the Cold War, there was revived hope for great leaps forward in terms of peace and security, as well as economic and social development for all the nations of the world. Soon, however, attention shifted to how the winners of the Cold War, or rather the winner, would run the new world order, which we were assured had been established following the dissolution of the Soviet Union and the first US-led war in the Gulf to liberate Kuwait. At the same time, some gloomily warned of a clash of civilizations between the West and others, especially between the West and Islam. They felt their predictions were vindicated following the 11th of September 2001 attacks on New York and Washington. In their view, the acts of 19 individuals and the small group behind them proved that the whole of Islam was at war with the West, and that Islam was incompatible with Western ideals. And this violence, not just the attacks of the 9/11, but the violence throughout the region was characterized as terrorism with a capital T, and seen by enthusiastic supporters of the clash of civilization theory as further vindication of their views. This led to the use and abuse of the words culture and civilization in heated debates conducted by politicians and academics in and out of context at national, regional, and international levels. But is it really inevitable in this so-called global village of ours for civilizations to clash violently, as some predicted and still maintain? Or is it possible for political leaders, thinkers, educators, economic actors, as well as active members of civil society, to responsibly create space for mutual understanding and respect, tolerance, cooperation, solidarity, or harmony, to use the language of the forum, to flourish among the various parts of the richly diverse human family? Perhaps nothing discredited the clash of civilization theory more than the Arab Spring at its beginnings. Everyone was caught by surprise when the desperate act of a young Tunisian sparked an uprising that quickly spread from country to country. The Arab people were demanding the very rights, freedoms, and institutions that, it had been argued, did not matter to them. The dissatisfaction of the masses, especially the young, with the manner in which their countries were being governed, had been well known to everyone. Despite decades of oppression by regimes often coddled by Western governments, the demand for change had been real and growing. But the governments themselves were not listening. What was unexpected to both Arab and non-Arab observers was the sudden eruption of that dissatisfaction into huge, spontaneous, popular demonstrations. It was also surprising that those demonstrations had no well-known leaders, yet they were well-organized and mature. In spite of persistent provocations by the security forces, the demonstrations remained peaceful until the end in Tunisia and Egypt, and for several months in Syria. An even bigger surprise was how quickly the basic objectives of the masses was achieved in Tunisia and Egypt. President Ben Ali of Tunisia hurriedly left the country, and President Mubarak resigned a mere 3 weeks after the beginning of what Egyptians now call the January 25th revolution. In Libya, the first tremors were felt in mid-February, literally one day after President Mubarak resigned. NATO interpreted Security Council Resolution 1973 as authorizing military intervention. They stated, however, that they would not put troops on the ground or seek regime change in Libya. In actual fact, they and their regional allies did put troops on the ground and did seek and achieve regime change in Libya. They believed it would take no more than a few weeks, perhaps even a few days, to achieve their aims. But it took them 8 months at the cost of billions, massive destructions in Libya, and countless casualties amongst Libyan civilians. Looking at Libya today, it would be a gross exaggeration to say that Western military intervention had been a resounding success. By the time the Arab Spring reached Syria, regional and international powers, political observers, and the media were determined not to repeat the mistakes and poor judgments made regarding Tunisia and Egypt. Ben Ali and Mubarak had fallen in less than a month. Surely, Bashar al-Assad in Syria would not last much longer. It was therefore safe and cost-free to predict and call for his downfall. But as we know, this was wrong again. In Yemen, the unrest had started well before 2010, and Al-Qaeda had begun to establish itself there solidly soon after the US invasion of Iraq. With the meddling of Iran and the military intervention led by Saudi Arabia, a full-fledged civil war and regional war are now taking place in the country. Ladies and gentlemen, looking at the bloodshed, displacement, and uncertainty that prevail in the region, it is understandable that people are asking if these are genuine revolutions, perhaps still struggling, but overall a positive development for the peace of the region. Or where is it the case that, on the contrary, these uprisings were a negative force, a false promise that gave people false hopes, then led to needless bloodshed and setbacks, and setback these countries and the region as a whole? And was our enthusiasm, therefore, and support totally misplaced? Another question is the impact these events have had on the rise of political Islam. The Arab Spring seemed to open up a historic opportunity for political Islam at long last to gain acceptance on the political map of the entire region. There was reasonable success for Islamic political parties in the Maghreb countries, except in Libya, but the opportunity seems to have been missed by them in Egypt, which, at the beginning, appeared to be the big prize for the Muslim Brothers movement. But others also lay claim to Islamic agendas in our region. Al-Qaeda remains a force, both in its original breeding ground of Afghanistan and Pakistan, and through its numerous franchises in the Maghreb, the Sahel region, Iraq, Yemen, Somalia, and elsewhere, especially now in Syria. And there is a new arrival on the scene. The Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, known to you as ISIS or ISIL, and to us in the Middle East as Daesh, which is expanding rapidly in the Muslim world and attracting new jihadists from a score of countries all over the world. Some act all over the world as if Al-Qaeda and Daesh descended on us from an outer planet. Let's not forget, in fact, that the founder of Al-Qaeda, Osama bin Laden, came to Afghanistan from Saudi Arabia as part of the joint US-Pakistani-Saudi effort to fight the Soviet Union in Afghanistan. And Daesh grew in response to the US invasion of Iraq and the sectarian government that took over that country as a result of that invasion and occupation. Most of the original leaders and cadres of Daesh had been officers in the army of Saddam Hussein, which Mr. Paul Bremer III, head of the US pseudo-colonial administration, had dissolved with the stroke of a pen. The main Islamic movements, such as the Muslim Brotherhood, deny any relationship with extremist movements such as Al-Qaeda or Daesh. And I think, indeed, they do not have any relations with them. Yet, they and the Muslim world must also accept that these extremist movements originated in their midst. And they, these countries, these organizations, they need to develop an understanding of how that happened in their midst and how they can today contribute effectively to protecting their youth from being drawn to extremism. What Daesh and similar groups are doing must be condemned and fought with determination by Muslims and non-Muslims alike. At the same time, we all know that Muslim communities are also discriminated against and deprived of their basic rights in many parts of the world, including in Europe and in many Asian countries, large and small. Ladies and gentlemen, I will now return to my initial question. Is the Arab Spring a reality or a mirage? Whatever we call them, momentous events did take place in North Africa and West Asia over the past 5 years. Millions of people took to the streets in every town and in every village in Tunisia and Egypt, in Libya, Yemen, Syria, and elsewhere, to say, as some do, that these developments were inspired, manipulated, and financed from abroad is disrespectful to those millions of demonstrators. Their courage, their dignity, their idealism, their sacrifices must not be forgotten or ignored. There was, therefore, an Arab Spring. The Arab Spring has existed. What was naive was the over-enthusiastic belief that it was going to be eternal spring, instantly, all over the region. Such magical transformations happen only in fairy tales. Social and economic conditions, as well as cultural realities, are important determining factors. And in our increasingly connected world, developments in one country or region cannot evolve in isolation from what goes on in the rest of the world. In our region more than elsewhere, foreign influence and interference are part of the daily reality. It is the deplorable social, economic, and cultural situation that pushed the masses into the streets in the first place. And the regimes in our region built strong state institutions and the regime in our part of the world did not build state institutions and did not cultivate a tradition of rule of law. Instead, Syria, Egypt, Tunisia, all were states dominated by intelligence services and secret police. And in every country, the education system has been neglected, and corruption reigned supreme. Growing tensions between Sunni and Shia Muslims have now become a major political factor and a worrying one in the region. This phenomenon was devastating at one time in Afghanistan. Now, confrontations happen almost routinely in Pakistan. In Lebanon, tensions and mutual suspicion between Shia and Sunni Muslims are now much more acute than between Muslims and Christians. In Iraq, a vicious sectarian war has raged for several years, and reconciliation is much talked about, but not implemented. Ladies and gentlemen, in the weeks leading up to this year's United Nations General Assembly, there had been hope, especially following the Iran nuclear deal, that at long last, progress would be made towards a peaceful solution to the terrible multiple crises in the region, especially Syria. That dialogue, however, did not take place in New York last September. Dialogue does seem to have started in Vienna a couple of weeks ago. Let's hope that the powers that be have now understood that Daesh cannot be defeated through bombing campaigns alone, no matter how many countries participate in those campaigns, and no matter whether these campaigns are organized in one coalition or two or more. Sadly, while everyone pays lip service to the idea that there is no military solution in Syria and all must work for a political solution, in reality, until now, all parties have been working for a military, not a political solution. Today, about half of the total population of Syria has been displaced, including well over 4 million who left the country. Of those refugees, hundreds of thousands have reached Europe. European countries have been understandably overwhelmed by the flood of refuge seekers knocking at the door of what some call Fortress Europe. This should not have come as a surprise to them or to anyone else. It was predictable and it was predicted. A few European leaders have shown a high sense of responsibility, leadership, and solidarity. Also, countless European citizens have generously mobilized to offer assistance to refugees from Syria and elsewhere. They all deserve recognition, gratitude, and admiration. On the other hand, an ugly discourse of hate, discrimination, and racism is also spreading in Europe, including among government leaders, politicians, and intellectuals. Is it necessary, really, to remind Europeans and others that tiny Lebanon is already bearing the burden of hosting around 2 million Syrian refugees? And is it necessary to explain that the flow of refugees out of Syria will cease only when the Syrian crisis has been justly resolved? The conflicts in the region are spiraling out of control. Let's hope that international and regional powers, as well as the parties themselves, can put aside their narrow, selfish interests and incompatible narratives before it is too late. Whether the Arab Spring was a reality or a mirage, there can be no hope of achieving the legitimate aspirations of the peoples of the region for dignity, equality, the rule of law, and development until the conflicts and bloodsheds are brought to an end. If they wish to have a future, the ruling governments must recognize that the world around them has changed, and they can no longer deny people their rights. Ladies and gentlemen, to conclude, I will return to the general debate at the United Nations in September, where there was a strong and worrying smell of nostalgia for the Cold War and its practices, especially when timid attempts were made to discuss Middle East issues. Fortunately, there were also uplifting statements and promising commitments to international cooperation for the building of a better world for future generations. A good example of those encouraging words are the following quotes taken from the speech of His Excellency President Xi Jinping of China, and I quote, "We should build partnerships in which countries treat each other as equals, engage in mutual consultations, and show mutual understanding. We should be committed to multilateralism and reject unilateralism. We should abandon Cold War mentality in all its manifestations and foster a new vision of common, comprehensive, and sustainable security. In their interaction, civilizations must accept their differences. Only through mutual respect, mutual learning, and harmonious coexistence can the world maintain its diversity and thrive. Each civilization represents the unique vision and contribution of its people, and no civilization is superior to others. Different civilizations should have dialogue and exchange instead of trying to exclude or replace. The history of mankind is a process of active exchanges, interactions, and integration among different civilizations. We should respect all civilizations and treat each other as equals. We should draw inspiration from each other to boost the creative development of human civilization." I think this is a very good message to this conference. Thank you very much indeed.